first and the last, you're the Alpha and the Omega, you're the beginning and the end, you're the Ancient of Days. Before we were ever even thought of, you are. And before this world was ever made, you conceived of us in your eternal mind. And you made us with your hands. Lord, you are the source of everything. Everything comes from you. There is none greater, there's none higher, there's none more powerful than you. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. Lord, we give you all the praise today. We say that you are high and lifted up.
Jesus.
alive in this place. Jesus, take us by the hand, lead us. We can't possibly comprehend the scriptures without you. We have no understanding of your word until you explain it to us. Jesus, be our teacher today. Come, as we walk along the road with you, explain the parables to us. Teach us the things that the others don't have the opportunity to hear. Show us the intimate secrets, the revelations, the private things. Give us a private audience, Lord. Even this day, let us be able to receive revelations that no one has ever received before. New precious jewels from heaven. Shiny gold nuggets dropping out from heaven right into our hands. Give us the gift of your word today. Anoint it. We come to you with hungry hearts. We come to you with thirsty souls. To whom else shall we go? You are the one with the words of eternal life. You're our only source. You're our only satisfaction. Every moment that I'm away, that I'm not completely focused on you, I'm wholly unsatiated. Barrenness resides in me when I don't think about you. But the very moment I just imagine you, think about how precious you are, the flood of your glory comes back upon me. In just a moment, just an instant, even in a fraction of a second, everything changes when we turn our eyes towards you.
For this day, here in this place, the throne of grace,
I obtain mercy. Son of David,
have mercy.
Have mercy. I thank you for it today. I thank you for it today, Jesus. We believe in you. Just because we believe, you counted unto us as righteousness. And in a moment, as we believe, you take all iniquity away, you take all sin away, and instead you impute to us the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And we're clean. We're pure. He's adorned you with white robes. They're on you now. He's dressed you in a spotless garment. Just because you believe, just because you believe, just because you accept. That's why he said, come with me, come, let's reason together. I want to make a deal. I know your sins are red like scarlet, but you'll be white like snow if you come to me. If you just admit, if you just submit, if you just confess that you're unable, that you're incapable, you'll find everything you need. I call out, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. You're fighting to be pure. You're fighting to be holy. But the fact is, you will never achieve holiness on your own. You'll never be able to be as good as you think you need to be to please me. Your goodness is not what I'm looking for. It's your yieldedness. It's your submission to my spirit. It's your acceptance of the fact that you are completely unable. When you realize your worthlessness before me, then I will lift you up. I'll use you. I'll exalt you. And I will make a great name for you. And I will cause wonderful things to happen through you. And I will give you favor with men. And nations even will come to you and ask for your help. People will come and ask for your great wisdom that you will always know has nothing to do with you at all. And then it's not even your wisdom. Because I put it on you like a garment. Let me dress you, says God. Let me dress you today. Come on, throw off that filthy garment. Throw it off. Throw off the garment of the flesh. Throw off the clothes of this world. You don't need the dresses of this age. You don't need the fashions of this time. Let me put my eternal robes on you. Let me drape you in heaven's splendor. Let me wrap you up. Let me wrap you in the finest linen woven in eternity for you. The finest linen. Let me wrap you up. Let me wrap you up. I will hide you in my splendor. I will hide you in my glory. You must understand that your acceptance of the covenant that I've made through the blood of Jesus Christ, through the blood of the Lamb, is your entrance into this arrangement that causes you to be free from every spot, every blemish, every sin, and to be given absolute purity in a moment, in just a flash. You are made perfect because I said so. Because I said so. And who could argue with me, says God? Who would dare speak a word in contrary to what I say and to what I speak? What could ever separate you from my love for you? What could ever divide you from me? Nothing. Nothing can take you out of my hands. If you remain, if you stay there, you are my precious lamb. And I am the good shepherd. You can trust me. You can trust me. Jesus. covenants that we have with God throughout the Bible. Two of my favorite are Yahweh Sikenu and Yahweh Ukadesh. The first is God, our righteousness. Just as our father Abraham believed God and was counted to him as righteous, as we are in right standing with God. The moment we believe and say it, and we speak to the Lord, we are made right. And God's confused why we go back in time and dig up our filth. Like a dog going back to its vomit and licking it up. He's confused why you revisit. Why do you go back and find the faults? Why do you go back and look for the errors and look for the weaknesses? You choose weakness. You choose the dark past over the present light given from heaven. So make a choice. Set your affection on things above, not on things of the earth. Set your heart on the heavenly things. It's up to you. It's up to you. You can be whoever you let the Lord make you. But you will always have the will and the ability to stop him. You will always be able to resist him. So the Lord calls you to be righteous. He is our righteousness. And the second is Kadesh. He is our sanctifier. He's our sanctifier. Which means he cleanses and purifies us again and again and again. He keeps us pure. Just like the human body, you don't bathe it once and that's it. You have to take baths again and again. You have to be washed. So we are washed in the water of the Word. We're cleansed in the blood of the Lamb. The reason people were dying and were sick in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians is because they did not appreciate, they did not remember, they did not rehearse the work of the cross. They didn't go back to Calvary. They left it behind. You have to stay. You have to stay where Jesus is. You have to stay where the sacrifice was made. You can never afford to forget it. Forget not the benefits of the Lord. Forget not the covenant of the Lord. Rehearse it. Every day you need to get saved. Every day you need to come to Calvary. Every day you need to see the nails. Every day you need to see the crown on his head. Every day you need to see the stripes on his back. Every day. Revelation of salvation is our manna of today. It's new every morning. His mercy is new every morning. Every morning. We yield to it again today. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for washing us, Lord. We enjoy the covenant with all of its benefits. Saved, and was number 186 and number 185 when Jesus traveled toward Jerusalem. And we were talking about the fact that the whole way he traveled, he was preaching and teaching and going through synagogues, going through the streets. People were coming to him the whole way. He left a trail of healed people.
and miraculous stories. Everywhere Jesus goes is a miracle. Anytime Jesus walks through a place, it changes. You can't have Jesus walk through a place without something happening. Jesus is going to make something happen. You cannot welcome Jesus in your life without something spectacular happening in your life. You let him walk with you. Let him talk to you. Fellowship with the Holy Spirit of God, and wonderful things will always happen. Luke chapter 13, verse 31. At that time, some Pharisees came to Jesus and said to him, "Leave this place and go somewhere else. Herod wants to kill you." He replied, "Go tell that fox, I will drive out demons and heal people today and tomorrow. And on the third day, I will reach my goal. In any case, I must keep going today and tomorrow and the next day, for surely no prophet can die outside Jerusalem. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who killed the prophets and stoned those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" Now, this is a very important moment. Jerusalem, of course, is the holy city of God, was the holy city of God. And I know there's a lot of focus on Jerusalem, and we take a lot of Old Testament scriptures about Jerusalem, but in the new dispensation, Jesus crossed the line concerning his regard for Jerusalem. And he said it would be left to them desolate, and desolation came to Jerusalem as a result. And they tried to, even during the time of the Maccabees and throughout the 400 years of silence between the Old and New Testament, there's lots of things right now. There's a coming home of many Jews, an unprecedented numbers that are populating Jerusalem, and it's moving toward the end, and there will be people there, but and it's prophetically a lot will play out, but Jesus basically here expressing the words of the Father. He was lamenting at how much he loved the Jewish people that dwelt in Jerusalem, and he called it Jerusalem, being the people of that area. He loved them and he wanted to gather them, but they were not willing. So because they rejected him, he was rejecting them. "And you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" And he was quoting a scripture where it says about the honored prophet comes and you say, "Blessed is the one." It's the way that you receive someone and say, "You are welcome." And "well come" means blessed coming. And so that's all it was. Until you welcome me back and say, "You are now welcome," I will not. So in other words, until they call out the name of Jesus, there's no interaction between them and the Father. They cannot connect to the Father without Jesus. I don't care how Jewish they get. I don't care if they restore everything and they're keeping the law completely. It's too late. Jesus is now the way to the Father. And therefore, he changed everything, changed, and he turned his attention away from them and turned it to the whole world, to the Gentiles. And this plays out throughout the rest of the Gospels, also into the book of Acts, all the way up to the 10th chapter of Acts, where Peter and Cornelius meet together, and that's the first real official pouring out of the Spirit on the Gentiles. And Jesus fulfilled the prophecy of the sheep of another pasture that he talked about, and he finished that. How many times did Jesus say, "You Jews are going to want to come into the kingdom, but you'll be thrown out, and instead the foreigners will come and take your place, because I've come to you, but you've not received me"? And he's very angry. And this is not the first time that God was rejecting the Jewish people. Jesus is the only one. Now, there's a lot of cultural things that are beautiful about the Jewish culture that are biblical and follow that. And you can be Jewish if you are Jewish in culture and you raise your whole life as a Jew and then you get saved. That's one thing. Then God does not circumvent culture. He's going to leave you in your culture and you're going to know Jesus, name Jesus as Savior, and then you would become a Jew for Jesus. A valid group. Jews for Jesus. Very powerful institution. Their whole mission is get Jews saved and convincing Jews that Judaism is not going to get them to heaven. So they're wonderful. They have wonderful music. If you ever listened to some of the music of the Jews for Jesus in different groups, fascinating. But we are not supposed to emulate them. If you're not a Jew originally, there's no reason for you to become a Jew, no more than there is for you to become any other nationality. You don't have to emulate another nationality or another culture. There's no one culture that is more holy than another culture, including Judaism. Ultimately, if you think of Judaism and Islam side by side, one is not more holy than the other. But if you have Christianity, that can also be, if you're not adhering to the principles of Jesus, it's only those that do the will of the Father. So really, that also is not necessarily a road to the Father. Jesus is the road, not Christendom, the whole realm of religious activities. But Jesus now, we see his attitude toward Jerusalem. His heart is broken. He wants them. Paul wanted it too. Paul was so extreme in his prayer for his Jewish brothers that he said he would be willing to give up his own salvation if Israel could be saved. You better have a spirit of intercession on you to pray a prayer like that. I would never give up my salvation for anybody. But he was so tormented by the idea of his Jewish heritage and those people. When he got, these are supposed to be the people of God. To them come the promise, or from them come the promises, he says. He speaks all these words, but he always goes back to say that Jesus is the only way. We always want to keep our doctrine straight about it. What salvation is and who it is, and if you have any dealings with the Jewish person, it should be to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to them and tell them about what Jesus does for them. Number 188, in a Pharisee's house on the Sabbath, one Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. Because, you know, that's what they were doing. They were scrutinizing his every move, trying to find something to accuse him with. And not everyone was looking at him to accuse him. Some were looking at him just out of fascination to learn. And there are some of them who were converted to Christianity, or better said, to the way, believing in Jesus. And they became disciples of Jesus. So they're looking at him. And then we see a man with dropsy is healed in the second verse of chapter 14. There in front of him, while they're looking at him, there in front of him was a man suffering from dropsy. Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or no? What kind of question is this? He knows the answers to that. He's just challenging them. But they remain silent. So, taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him away. Then he asked them, if one of you has a son or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out? And they had nothing to say. They couldn't respond to it. This was actually repeated several times. Jesus made that same statement, the same idea. So that became his pat answer to give to them. Whenever he did something on the Sabbath, because it worked. You know, he found what worked, so why reinvent the wheel? He was happy with that. He just went around telling everybody from that point on. Repeats it. Oh, you have a problem with that? Oh, what happens if your ox falls into a ditch? Or into a pit on the Sabbath? Do you pull it out? Jesus thought, you know, oh, hey, this works. I'll just have to keep using it. Now we go and we see the parable of the guests. When he noticed, remember, he's in the Pharisee's house, which is an important man. We saw everybody's watching him, but you know what? This is the thing. They might be watching him, but he's watching them. He sees what they're doing, and he noticed how the guests pick the places of honor at the table. So he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do you take the place of honor for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited? If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, give this man your seat. Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, friend, move up to a better place. Then you will be honored in the presence of all your fellow guests. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. And the key is self-exaltation. Really, that's just the spirit of Lucifer. I will exalt my throne. I will put myself up high. No, you don't do that. You put yourself low. If you humble yourself, then God will exalt you. If you exalt yourself, then God will humble you. It's very simple. And Jesus is speaking this parable, and this applies to every area of life. No matter where you go, no matter what you do, don't look to be served. Look to serve and to help people. And he notices you and your life. He notices where you're sitting. He notices what you do. Number 191, parable to the host of the feast. Then Jesus said to his host, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they may invite you back, and so you will be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, and you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. And this is going back to what he said about it, whatever you did to the least of these, you do to me. Jesus meant this principle, lived this principle, taught this principle. He exemplified it in his life by always going to the little God, noticing above everyone else the one who had need. Notice the widow with her mites. Notice always the people who had need. Notice the man at the pool of Bethesda that had nobody to help him. Everybody else had somebody to help, but that little guy had nobody. And Jesus said, that's my guy. He loves the underdog. He loves the one that doesn't have. That's why the greatest encounters you'll ever have with the Lord are when you're in your most abandoned and helpless position. That's when he shows up. And that's why if you humble yourself, if you induce that environment for yourself, that's like a written invitation to God. But how would you then put yourself in a position to not have and not be able to take care or not? Well, you just give it all away. I've been there many times. You just give everything away and there's nothing left. And the bill has to be paid, but you don't have anything. Why don't you have anything? Well, I gave it all away. And you would think God would get mad at you because you gave everything. What? No, he comes because you have nothing. He's got to bail you out. He laughs the whole time. And of course, he comes at the very last minute. As we say, he's the God of the 11th hour. That's not true. He's the God of perfect timing. So he comes exactly when you need it. He's there. Ding. He comes and provides it. But if you weren't in a position to need it, then you're less likely to be close to the Lord and God will be less glorified in your life. So on all things being equal, you know, going back, and of course I'm always attacking this, the prosperity message basically is teaching you a lifestyle that will cause you to be able to be separate from God. Overall, if we're to truly have prosperity, it's setting ourselves, and I'm talking about prosperity like over, but that's what Jesus said about the man who built the other barn, and because he had so many goods and he had enough to build new storage so that he could eat, drink, be merry, take his ease and rest. But that's, he could have used that extra to bless and to take care of other people's needs. And there were people there that didn't have anything. And there is a balance where Jesus said, the poor you have with you always. And there's a balance because there are people who are poor because they're just stupid. They did stupid things. Or they're mentally deficient, and that happens too. People that just mentally, they're unstable. And you know, in the United States of America, we have homeless people. But if they are home, I remember one time I heard this from a man who was a very hardworking man, and he worked all the time. He was wealthy because he worked hard, and he was also very giving. So he had a balance in the issue of wealth. And the Lord made him a millionaire, but he gave millions away. I mean, he just lived it. He was living the example of what the scriptures teach us. And we were driving along one time. He was in the car, and he saw a homeless guy with a bucket on the side of the road. I'll work for food. It's actually not true. They're not going to work for food. Well, how do you know that? Because I've tried to get them to work for food. They don't want to work. They want you to give them money. But to make it look like I'm trying, they write on there, I'll work for food. Very common trick in America. I'll work for food. And you say, okay, well, why don't you come? And I have a friend of mine, he has a construction project, he's doing roofing. Now, yeah, oh, there's the truth. They'll sit there collecting change. They'll collect $2,000 to $3,000 on an intersection, depending on where the intersection is. Just out there, change. And so, you know, we can't benefit them. And anyway, I'm with this friend of mine. He sees the guy with the little bucket, and he says, "That is a selfish person." And I said, I thought, that's kind of, you know, politically incorrect to call a homeless guy selfish. And he said, "Those are the most selfish people in America, are the homeless." I thought, gosh, that really sounds cruel. But when he explained the logic to me, I saw. Because in most cases, they don't want to work. They want you to give them something. That's selfish, self-serving. We need to do something. We need to provide. We need to help. We need to do whatever we can to be a blessing. Now, if you work in the kingdom of God, you work not for a salary, but you're working and God notices, then he rewards you, because that's humbling yourself and God exalts you even financially. And Jesus is telling this man at this feast, who has this wonderful party going on, that of course he's invited to this supper, all of his friends and brothers and relatives and his rich neighbors. Why would you invite the rich? Because the rich are going to invite you back to their parties. And you're like accruing favor or points in the social system of, well, we got to invite them to the party because they invited us to their party. And so it goes on. And Jesus is saying, no, don't do that. You want to take care of and bless people that could never possibly ever pay you back. That way, you're not trusting in any kind of system. You're trusting only in God. And the way the Bible says in Proverbs, give to the poor and you're lending to the Lord, and he will surely repay you, it says. And this is what Jesus is advocating. He's asking us to do this. Now, when one of those at the table heard him say this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the man who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." He's talking about meals. They're there at a meal, and this guy's just thinking, looking at Jesus. He's believing in him enough to believe that he's coming to a kingdom. It's going to be a heavenly kingdom. And he even says, "Blessed is the one that eats there in the kingdom of God." Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests." Now, see, this guy's saying, that's going to be an awesome feast in the kingdom of God. Now, Jesus is responding to him and telling him, you got your invitation, but let me tell you something. A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, "Come, for everything is now ready." But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, "I have just bought a field. I must go and see it. Please excuse me." Another said, "I've just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me." Still another said, "I just got married, so I can't come." The servant came back and reported this to his master. Then the owner of the house became angry. Who's the owner of the house? The owner of the house is the one that's done the inviting. He's the one that set up everything. He's the one that set up the banquet, i.e. heavenly realm. God, in the analogy, God the Father is angry when he invites people to come and they don't come. And so he's angry according to this parable. And he ordered his servant, "Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame." Which, by the way, the ones that Jesus told him that he should invite before the other people anyway. Because they're going to come. You invite a homeless guy or a crippled person or a blind person that has no other way to be a part of a blessing in your life, it's more likely they're going to respond. "Sir," the servant said, "what you ordered has been done, but there is still room." Then the master told his servant, "Go out to the roads and country lanes and make them come in, so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those men who were invited will get a taste of my banquet." He wanted to. He wanted to make sure that every single spot was filled, just in case one of those guys came late, so that he could say to him, "Sire, there's no more room here." Now, we look at this as an analogy of what Jesus is talking about, the kingdom of heaven. He has this wonderful banquet, and oh, it will be the greatest banquet ever. The marriage supper of the Lamb is going to be amazing. Amazing. Jesus is so excited about it. When he ate the last meal, he said, "Man, this next meal is going to be incredible." And he invited everybody, because God's not willing that any should perish, but that everyone would come. So everybody has received in the spiritual manner an invitation to the wedding banquet. and they can be, they can come and be a part of the kingdom. But not everybody's making excuses. And God, for those who are making excuses, God's getting angry at them. And he's going to work out, if they keep making excuses, he's going to make sure there's no room left for them. And I don't know exactly how that's going to play out, but I imagine it has to do with the circumstances of their life, keeping them captive, and them not. And even if it occurs to them to be a part of the kingdom, now they've established this system around them that keeps them locked into a lifestyle away from God. Because that happens. A lot of, how many people you see not get saved because their lifestyle would have to die for them to get saved? Their cultural affiliation, their jobs, their education, their social order, everything. And that takes a lot, so they don't want to. They give excuse. God's going to find people to come wherever he's got to find them. So he finds people who are the rejects, who have no social order, no acceptance, and nobody wants them. And they're thrown out, and nobody wants to be a part of them. Hello, that's me. That's why I'm here today, because nobody wanted me, and nobody needed me, and nobody wanted to be around me, and I was rejected and mocked and made fun of all the time, and I was the poorest. I was the one that got the worst possible grades that you could get. I got zero. My grades were zero because I did nothing. There was no one with lower grades than me in school. No one as poor as I was the poorest person in the neighborhood. And so I was rejected for that. And I'm the guy in the alleyway. Basically, the Lord just came along and said, you know what, go to the wedding feast. No, you need to go. It says, make them come. So I was made to go. I complained, but he made, all right. But when I got in the wedding banquet room and I saw what was on the table, I was like, whoa, wait a minute. Oh, I'm staying here. This is delicious. I'm not leaving this place. So I've tasted and have seen that the Lord is good. He is delicious. Jesus is delicious. I'm going to write a song. Oh, Jesus is delicious. He said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no part of me, right? So, yum, yum, yum. I got Jesus in my tongue. Yum, yum, yum. I'm going to write a very odd praise song about eating Jesus. It'd be a good message, eating Jesus. It'd be a good t-shirt. Get people's attention, eating Jesus. Yeah, eating Jesus. What does that mean? Well, you got a few minutes? I can explain it to you. Whatever it takes to pique interest in the minds of people. Jesus is delicious. That'd be great. Do we have any graphic artists in the house that have the ability to print t-shirts and do things under? We could do that. So he's telling them, make them come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those men who were invited and made excuses and didn't want to come talking about their new wife and their animals they had to try out. And it's, you know, these are the reasons that they don't want to come. Well, then fine. Fine then. This shows that God is actually sensitive emotionally. He gets his feelings hurt. You see that throughout the parables, that Jesus is all God. The Father is often offended and angry because we hurt his feelings, because we didn't do what he needs us to do, and we didn't say thank you, and we didn't show gratitude, all those things. And they make excuses. Now, number 193, great multitudes travel with Jesus. It says in Luke 14:25, large crowds were traveling with Jesus. And turning to them, he said, and this is separate because you have to get a vision or a picture in your mind of this. Now, Jesus was walking with a smaller band, with 12, 70. Now he's got thousands of people. And this is toward the end because he's basically no longer prohibiting people from following him, so he's got this huge crowd going. And when Jesus came, you knew it because there was a large crowd. I read in the book of Acts that when the disciples were preaching the gospel, it says a large number of disciples were given to them. And when I read it, The Lord showed me Anne's face. Showed me Anne's face, and he said, I'm going to give her a large number of disciples. And right after he showed me that, she wrote me and told me that one of the girls that she's been associated with said, I want to be a Christian. Just to confirm what the Lord was telling me, large number of disciples. Keep your eyes on Anne. You're going to be walking down the road with a large crowd. And it's not going to be too much fun. She knows that, but she's willing to pay the price. It's hard work. The more people God gives you, the harder it is. Because you have to deal with their problems. You have to get down with OPP. Never heard that? Other people's problems. Get down with OPP. Get down with OPP. Their problems. Other people's problems. They come and tell you. You hear stories you'd wish you'd never heard. It creates images in your mind so horrific. And you begin to, you feel their darkness. And you repel it with the light of God. You just bring healing to people's lives. You heal them. This work, I've been doing it for years. It never gets any easier. But then when they're set free, they get up from the gate called Beautiful, and they couldn't walk before they met you, but now they can walk. And they're walking and leaping and praising God. You meet them, they're walking and leaping, praising God. So it says they're walking and leaping. And he followed them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And everybody saw him walking and leaping and praising God. It changes people. And when people see the change in someone, they say, wait, I want to be changed too. But it's sweet to see the Lord bringing large crowds traveling with Jesus. And the verse continues, the cost of discipleship and the cost of discipleship. They were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off, and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It's thrown out, because the manure actually is more valuable than the saltless dirt. At least you can sell manure as fertilizer. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Because there was a big crowd following him, he had an obligation now to tell them about discipleship. And that's part of it. When we get these people around us, we need to start to process the groups. We bring them from a mere understanding about Jesus into a dedication. First, salvation. They receive Jesus, but then we have to start bringing them to fidelity in Christ, commitment to Jesus. And it's all part of the task, the work that we have to do. Number 195, he eats with tax collectors and sinners. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. You know why they're gathering around to hear? Because it's the first religious leader of their time that accepted them. Because the Pharisees would not allow the tax collectors and quote unquote sinners to gather around them. Even if they wanted to, because of external religiosity, you had to first not be those things in order to even hear about God. And so first you clean yourself up and stop being those things, and then, because they had a doctrine of disassociation with everyone sinful, and Jesus reversed the doctrine and caused it to be association with everyone sinful. And he went where they were and hung out where they were hanging out to talk to them, to minister to them, to help them. And so, of course, they gathered around him, but the Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." They didn't like the idea of Jesus welcoming these people, and to them it meant that Jesus was probably not of God, because he wouldn't associate with these kinds of people. And so he begins this discourse about lost sheep, the coins that were lost, and the lost son, all about things that are lost. And it goes on for many verses from 3 to 32, but the theme is lost, lost sheep, coin, and son. That he's great concern about that which is lost. The sinners that he was so interested in is because he didn't come for the righteous and for the well, but he came to heal the sick. And he didn't just mean physically sick, he meant also spiritually sick, emotionally distraught. People who did not have it all together, people who were falling apart, people having nervous breakdowns, people who were suicidal, people who are on the edge, people who have no reason to live. He's so concerned with the lost. Jesus told them this parable: suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. And there was let's wait on this first one for a second. Go back to that. Well, at the moment, the young woman referred to said, "I would like to become a Christian." There was an explosion in heaven. As soon as that happens, there's just this, the angels start, the screams break out through all of heaven. The elders are high-fiving each other. God gets up, dances a jig in front of the throne. Everybody gets excited. The camp music starts, but boom, 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 boom. Everybody starts dancing. Yay! It's true, it's what the Bible says. That's the Bible. And you feel, if you're attuned to the Spirit, you feel it. When they say it, you feel like, oh, something's going on. You feel the joy of the Lord pouring out of heaven like loud neighbors. You hear it through the wall of time. You hear something's going on up there. It's so exciting. Most exciting moments of my life have been when it's happened in large groups. And I did a meeting, a crusade college area with a lot of young people in a basketball court. And it was a basketball stadium, really, a college basketball arena. And we had special meetings, and I was the speaker, and I went to preach to them, and they invited campuses of several universities to come, anybody that wanted to come, and they had this artist, this is how they drew the people, and they had this musical artist who was very famous in the secular world, and he was scheduled to do like a mini concert for free for this ministry that I was involved with, and they were really talented. And so he invited, they invited all the young people. The young people knew them, a lot of even the Muslims knew who the guy was from the radio. And so they came, free concert, why not? They came, we packed the place out with about 5,000 people. And, but before the concert started, I got to preach. And I got to share with them about the Good Shepherd. And the anointing was so strong that my interpreter, we were down, right when we were going up to actually share, the interpreter was in front of me. We had to go up these very steep stairs, almost a ladder. that went up to the platform. And the platform was high because we had that many people. You need to be, you know, you need like a 2 to 3 meter high platform. And I was getting ready to go up, and the interpreter that was with me, because at the time I couldn't speak enough Indonesian to do it, he was getting dizzy, and he says, "I feel dizzy." And I said, "It's okay. It's the Holy Spirit, because the anointing was real strong." He says, "I don't." I said, "Hey!" I shook him. I said, "I can't afford to lose you." I said, "Souls are on the line, buddy. You better stand up straight." I slapped him in the face. "Get, wake up, wake up." "Okay, okay." And when we went up on the stage, I grabbed his thighs and pushed him up the ladder behind me to make sure he got up. And he got up there, he looked at out of those 5,000 people, and he was weak in the knees. And I looked at him, I said, "You better do a good job." Because the people were behind me, he was in front of us, "You better do a good job. These people need Jesus." And we did, it was really good. And so about 3,500 kids received Jesus. And when it happened, you could feel it. Like, big parties started going on because a lot of them were really good. And the majority of the people in the room were Muslim. But when they heard Jesus preached as the Good Shepherd that loved them, they were eager to pray. Now, I don't know what happened after that, you know. They had pastors, they had to do follow-up and stuff. I don't know, but the fact is they did pray a prayer. They did want Jesus. He cares about those people. He cares about the lost. Things that are lost, specifically sheep, and then we go on now. Suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. This is Jesus giving the analogy compared to what the father feels about the lost ones, because he's getting criticized by the Pharisees for hanging out with the sinners and the tax collectors, the lost ones. And so he's giving them three stories. Suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now, what you have to understand about these coins in this particular case is they were part of a headdress, or it would either be a headdress or a necklace that had 10 coins, specifically gold coins in it, that were part of the dowry of the woman. And if one of the coins was lost, it was be devalued tremendously, not just 10% devalued, but like half or less, because it was complete with 10 coins. So it really gives us the image that when the Lord is missing someone from his kingdom, there is a task and a function for that lost person that it doesn't just mean there's one missing, it means that 9 others that are supposed to be part of a structure that God had preordained before the foundation of the world, they're going to be affected if that one key poor person does not come in and they need to get saved. That's why I really love the message that I heard Danny Oss preach one time to the lost. And he rebuked the lost people. He had a big crusade. And he rebuked the souls that did not know Jesus for not working in the kingdom of God. And he said, "You do not know Jesus. You're here today. And it is your responsibility to win souls." He rebuked them for not winning souls. But they were not even saved yet. But he rebuked them because of this principle that you have a place. Without you, the kingdom cannot be complete to do what God needs to do. So you owe God your soul so that you can take your place in the kingdom so that souls can get saved. And when he gave the altar call, hundreds of people came up and gave their heart to Jesus. Because they saw themselves, even as a lost person, they saw that there was a purpose for their life. Not just get saved so that they don't go to hell, but get saved for the purpose of fulfilling a great mission. And sometimes we are at a disadvantage when we project a gospel that's only a salvation gospel. You need to preach a purpose-driven gospel. You need to tell people that you need to get saved because there's a great purpose. Before the foundation of the world, God had a plan for you. Haven't you always known that there's a destiny that you need to find? Haven't you always felt that there's some purpose for your life? You can tell this to the lost people and they all agree because everybody knows it. That's why every movie we see on the movies and everything on television, all these shows have to deal with somebody fulfilling a destiny or a purpose, and they have had a special function. Everybody wants to have that because God put that in people's hearts. And we can get people saved with that mentality. And this is the one with the 10 coins. That one coin, Jesus wants it. Jesus continued. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to the fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here, I'm starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing, so he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and have never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" You see, all three of these stories are so beautiful in the picture of God's intense love. And you notice all three of them have to do with restoration or renovation. God's not in the business of demolition. He's in the business of restoration. That there was a coin. It was there, but it fell out and was lost. There was 100 sheep. But one of them left the group. There was two sons that were faithful in the home, but one of them went away and did the wrong things because his father gave him a free will to do whatever he wanted to do. Just as the Father gives us absolute free will, we can do what we want, we can go what we want, and you know what? He will even bless us to do it. God will bless you. When God showed me the option that I had for ministry or that life, that house, the yard, and the trampoline, and the cocker spaniel, and the built-in swimming pool, all those things I could have had, He would have blessed me to do that. But it would not have been the perfect will of the Lord for my life. And God cares for the one that goes off. Now, of course, the son had to go and learn lessons. And I guarantee you that from this point on, he was a faithful son. But the other son who remained faithful will never have the perspective or the understanding of the love of the Father like that son does. The one that loves much is forgiven much. And that's why you see so many analogies just in this parable about religious activities, people who are even raised in a Christian home. That's not always the best people because they need to, you almost need to sin to know forgiveness. You almost need to do something really dumb and really horrible to really understand how much God loves you. And this son could not possibly comprehend the love of his father. It was never demonstrated and proven to him. He just knew it by words. He was there. He could guess that, okay, I have things I'm provided for. But until he went away and did something completely deserving of rejection and even death, he should not have been accepted by the Father. And then humility was embedded in him enough to, when he came back, he was not expecting to be restored as a son. He had no hope of that at all. He had no aspirations of getting his old place back. But he reasoned, he came to himself and reasoned, yeah, but even the hired servants in the slaves' portions that they have, they eat to their full and still have food left on their slave plates and their servant plates. And I have nothing to eat. I'd be better off as a slave in my father's house than being out here by myself. And so he went back expecting the cold shoulder. He probably didn't even expect to be treated by his father at all. Maybe even a servant would just take him in the ranks of the other servants and the father would treat him that way. But the father never stopped looking down the road. From the day his boy left, the father's heart was broken. And he looked and waited and waited and waited. Whenever one of God's people gets off on a tangent, does a stupid thing, God didn't just say, well, forget them. No, he's looking for them. He's waiting. He's wanting them to come back. I love meeting Christians who've lost their way. I love meeting missionaries and ministers who were in the ministry but did something stupid and they end up gone. I love restoring ministries. And I've done it a number of times. Found people who were discarded, thrown out, as my friend Mike Gaskin refers to it, whose swords were broken and thrown out of the fort. It's an old term that, you know, they you're busted and broken and they crack your sword in half and kick you out of the fort because that's what the body of Christ does often to its own. But that, see, to God, it's the lost son. It's not somebody to be punished and scorned. It's somebody to be longed for and hoped to return. And if they do return, the Father treats them with greater honor than he will treat you, the faithful. And I've seen this to be true. Almost makes you want to sin so you can get in on the deal. Of course, we won't do that. But I've seen God do amazing things. The ultimate idea of this is that God loves the lost one. He loves the people who, you know, really, how can I say this? I find that in a maturity process with believers, God will often allow them to sin by not putting a heavy hand of conviction on them and by causing it to become easy to make mistakes. Only not because he wants them to sin, he wants them to be righteous, but he knows that if you do something stupid, it will put you in a better position toward him. And it's almost like God allows, it's almost like God, he could not possibly enjoy it. There's nothing that the father enjoyed about the son being out there in riotous living with prostitutes and wasting money. But the father got back the son who died and was alive again with a loyalty and a dedication. And I'm sure the father had to think at times, it's a good thing, it's better than... How many times have you seen people that have been through hell and back and you think, you know what, it's the best thing that ever happened to them? How many people you see, they're criminals, they ended up going to jail, and jail was the best thing that ever happened. They get out of prison, and then they're a productive member of society because they paid a price, and it's the best thing that could have happened. Sometimes it happens in God's kingdom. But God loves, Jesus loves, and he wants his people to be close to him. Now, concerning servants, we see a parable of the unrighteous steward. This is Luke chapter 16, beginning in the first verse. Jesus told his disciples, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So this is a rich man, and he has a manager or an employee under him who is obviously a financial administrator of sorts that is governing the flow of the finances. And there's something that he's doing that's not good, that it's a waste, either embezzling or not doing wise business, whatever the case. So he called him in and asked him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer. Now the manager said to himself, what shall I do now? My master has taken away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job, which he thought was absolute, when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses. So he called in each one of his master's debtors. In other words, there were people who had done business with the master. He knew them because he was the administrator of the finances and the loans that were paid for whatever products that the master had. We're going to see in a moment, whether it be oil or whatever. Whatever you owe, you had to do it through this clerk or through this administrator. So he calls these people to accrue favor with them so that when he loses his job, they'll treat him right. He does something sneaky. He asks the first, how much do you owe my master? 800 gallons of olive oil.
That's a lot of olive oil.
That's in today's economy, 800 gallons of olive oil. If it's extra virgin, first press, olive oil, 800 gallons. I'd like to do the math on that. I didn't in preparation because I do no preparations for this class. But if I had, I would have calculated how much that was. If a small bottle is about, what, $10 for maybe more, $15 for a bottle, about that big, and it'd be like 6 or 8 of those for 1 gallon. So that's about maybe $50-$60 for a gallon times 800. So when I do the math, 50 times 800, he owed him a lot. He owed him a lot. So somebody do the math? Was that $40,000? Did I guess that right? Mm-hmm. 45-year-old brain still works, you see. So, 800 gallons of olive oil. He replied, the manager told him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 400. So instead of owing $40,000, he reduced his debt by $20,000, down to just $20,000. How many of you know he just made a friend? He basically, with no loss of his own, in this last desperate attempt, he changed the books and made it look like on the books the guy owed 20,000. Then he asked the second, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, take your bill and make it 800. So he gave him 20% off his bill, right? Because there's 1,000, 800, make it as if you really owe 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of the light. And this is Jesus talking about there's two kinds of people in the world, either in the eternal age or you're in the temporal age. You live by time or you live by eternity. You live by the light or you live according to this age. We've seen Jesus separate throughout this entire class. He's always marking the difference. People of the kingdom, people who are not of the kingdom. We have goats, we have sheep. We have weeds, we have wheat. And we're one or the other. There's no in between. And he's saying, you know what, it's funny, the people who are not, they seem to be wiser when it comes to these things, the wealth. And he says, I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? And of course, this is speaking of a spiritual perspective as well as a natural perspective. that Jesus is talking about the fact that you have to be faithful with everything that comes into your hand. No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, and he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Remember, he's making a distinction. Isn't it interesting? He's making a distinction between the children of this world and the children of light. And he has not associated the financial ideals to the children of light at all. Once again, looking at the prosperity message in light of this, you either serve God or you serve money. That's why I have so much trouble bringing these principles of some of the teachings I've heard, but Jesus always brings a distinction between the two and then doesn't connect them. He separates them. Serve God. If you seek first the kingdom, the money's going to come to you anyway. So better just serve God and he will... It's kind of like we have this secret, those of us who really operate in the kingdom principles. It's not fair. Because it's not fair, because God's not a fair God. He's a just God. He does what he wants. He's king. And when we buy into that and believe it by faith, we're released into a whole universe of unfairness. That he takes from the rich and gives to the poor. He'll take money that they've saved up and give it to you. You didn't work for it. That's not fair. You're serving the Lord, but technically you didn't work. I mean, you're doing what God called you to do. And they've done what they've done in the economy of this world, and there's been wealth produced, but it comes somehow, it ends up in your hands. Because ultimately, at the end of the day, God is in control of everything. And he controls all the finances of the world. And he controls the hearts of men that are, even if they're not yielded to him, he raises kings up, he brings kings down. So if we just trust him, he's going to take care of everything. Just put the Lord first. And this is so ludicrous to anybody who does not live by these things. Number one opposition for our missionaries, the training, they go, well, how are you going to get money? Well, I'm not. God's going to give me money. That's so crazy. That's not even possible. Not only is it possible, but after doing it for 30 years, I've found that it's unavoidable. It will always happen. It has always happened. I've never gone without it. I mean, I've gone with less than I might want, but that was good for me. Because actually, famine is more advantageous to you than harvest. Because it grows you. It's better. Trials are better. Difficulties. Persecution is much more valuable than blessings. Much more valuable. It sharpens you and grows you. And the highest quality people you know are the ones that have been through the most difficult things in life. Those are the people of value that you meet. You think, that's a good guy. Why? Because he's been through hell and back. And it tempered him and made him appreciative of all things. He's generous and kind and open. And he's wise. He's slow to anger. I mean, all these things you find about people because they've been tempered by difficulties. And the Lord is with us. Number 198, the Pharisees scoff at teaching on divorce. The Pharisees who love money. Right, remember the love of money is the root of all evil. The Pharisees who love money heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. Yeah, because when you talk about these principles that we learn from Jesus, you get sneered at. You ever see a sneer? Sneer. It's a look of contempt and disgust. And of course, they're angry because why? Because they love money. You know, religious leaders love money. If you believe me, once again, he's made a distinction. He's already told them who their father was. So if you're allied to a religious principle and connected not to God's kingdom, but to the religious hierarchy and the way it works, then you're operating and you will love money because money makes that world go around. And so you need the money from whatever you're doing. And so when they heard this, they got angry at Jesus and sneered at him. He said to them, you're the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of men. But God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight. And I have found that to be true so often that the men, the most valuable thing. All right, I'll challenge you with this. How important do you think to God is a Louis Vuitton purse? Do you think God looks at a Louis Vuitton bag and says, I mean, I don't have a problem with a Louis Vuitton bag. I think they're nice, but God can care less about you. That's why if you really want one, God can give you one. He'll get it for you. He'll give you the money to get into it. It's not even an issue. But these are the things that are considered so precious to people. Things, stuff, you know, Bruno Mali shoes or Armani suit or all these things, you know, that people, very expensive colognes, and they're all good. Or you can go to Fair Price and get the $8 one, which is really actually a pretty good collection. And you can tell where I shop for cologne. It's actually pretty good. And it comes with a little travel bottle besides. $8 for the full bottle of cologne with a travel pouch. And they have 5 different kinds of cologne for men. It's not like it used to be. When I was growing up, we had Old Spice. Nasty smell. We had Old Spice and Brut. That was it. And so you could smell a cheap man, because you knew. From one of those smells, that's a cheap cologne. But now you can get away with the cheap cologne, and it doesn't smell too cheap. Go check it out sometime. You'll be surprised what's available. So what is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight. The law and the prophets were proclaimed until John. Since that time, the good news of the kingdom of God is being preached, and everyone is forcing his way into it. It is easier for heaven and earth to disappear than for the least stroke of a pen to drop out of the law. Everyone who divorces his wife and marries another woman commits adultery. And the man who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now this is strange that he would tag this on to here out of nowhere. The only way we can conclude that he threw this in there, seemingly unrelated, was because they had done this. But the Pharisees had found a way to even just ahead. They found loopholes in the law to do away with wives, and so they could get the young girl and do what they wanted to do. And they did every form of corruption you can imagine. So Jesus was just, he already had them about the money issue, so now he's going to throw the marriage issue in there too. Make them even more angry. But he, in the middle there, he talks about the law and the prophets. So there was a time that we lived by the prophets, but that is up until John. At that time, since that time, the good news of the kingdom of God is being preached because the dispensation changed to a new era in the new time where everyone who wants it is forcing their way into it, into the kingdom of God. And in another place it says, takes it by force. And now we see number 199, the rich man and Lazarus. This is a very powerful story. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. And remember what context he's in now. He's telling this story having told the Pharisees who were angry at him because of his criticism of people focusing on money. And they loved money, so they were angry at him. And now he's telling them stories about their error. And he says, there was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores, and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue because I am in agony in his fire. Leave it right here for a second, please. And it's interesting to note this, that you have to get the understanding of the word hell here is not Gehenna, the word is Hades, so it's the grave. We talked about this in a class before. So in hell, in Hades, in the grave, in the subterranean cavernous regions of the holding room for the souls of men before going to the lake of fire, it was adjacent paradise by the abyss that was between them. And he could see them, Abraham He saw him far away, but he could still see him, which I think is more cruel than even being in hell, would be to have to look at paradise across the abyss. You see it there while you're waiting. And because it's a different age and time, I don't imagine they had to have a lot of mercy toward the people in hell. They may have even mocked them. We're in paradise. But still, he saw enough to be able to yell out and have a conversation. That's pretty close. That's a chasm, but it's close enough that he could talk to it. Father Abraham, have pity on me. Dip the tip of the finger, please give me, just have him put a little bit of water. And then the scripture continues. But Abraham replied, son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us. He answered, then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Abraham replied, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them. No, Father Abraham, he said, but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent. He said to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead. And he knew this in foreknowledge of what was going to happen with him. And even though he rose, it didn't mean that people were going to believe that they could see him. Even though he showed himself for 40 days after his resurrection to be alive to his own, there were still people who chose not to believe. This is a really powerful story. And I don't know, it just kind of makes me start. The first times I read it as a young Christian, I thought, well, then God wants us to live this life of poverty. The one with the advantage here is the one that had absolutely nothing. So to have anything really made me wrestle. I get it now through the years as I've lived. I understand what he meant. He meant that we walk in a place of sharing and generosity, that we give and we bless everyone so that we can be together in blessings, because God never really wanted on the earth for there to be people with this great disparity of shared wealth, that they have these mountains of money. And there's enough money on planet Earth right now for every single living human being to have like $1.7 million. There's enough money for every human being to be more than a millionaire right now on the Earth in currency, not even in assets, you understand? I'm talking about in liquid currency. Now, also we know because of the principle of responsibility and stewardship, that would be a disaster to suddenly spread all the wealth out. Because people would do, as you know, you can give a fool $1 million and 6 months later it's gone. They won't invest it, they just won't do the right thing with it. So there's reasons why people, the one that has most more is given for the reasons of their fidelity with what they have. But I see a whole different idea. If we really think about the words that Jesus spoke to us concerning wealth and the difference between the people of this age and the people of light that are us, that we're called out of darkness into his light, then we need to really think carefully about the way we live and the way we spend and what we do and in the environment you're in. And now there's extremes to this. If we start thinking, well, then first of all, if this were absolutely true, that if we're spending more than other people in the world and we're in sin, well, then all of Singapore is in sin. The poorest of Singapore are in sin. The poorest that you know are in sin, because I've seen the real poorest. See people eating leaves out of trees to survive in Indian villages, remote places that are so poor that they don't have clothes, they don't have anything, they have to eat leaves to stay alive. That's poor during famine, during difficulties. Well, you know, if I did sell everything I had all at once, gave everything away when I saw them, then how would I get back out of the village, give them my car, give them all my things? I'd have to walk naked. There's limitations to what the Lord's asking you to do. But if you listen to him, you'll find he doesn't want what you have. He wants the part that you have beyond. And he wants to give you that, not so that you can hold on to it, but so that you can redistribute it. And as you do that, I find that God increases what you retain. But the percentage is there. So you're giving and blessing, but he gives you more and more and blesses you. And also, as the scripture says, people give to you and bless you and give you those things. He wants to take care of you. But he instructs his disciples. This is number 200. We're going to cover this. This will be the last one. Jesus said to his disciples, things that cause people to sin are bound to come. But woe to that person through whom they come. It would be better for him to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around his neck than for him to cause one of these little ones to sin. So watch yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. If he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times comes back to you and says, I repent, forgive him. The apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. He replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you. Suppose one of you had a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Would he say to the servant when he comes in from the field, come along now and sit down to eat? Would he not rather say, prepare my supper, get yourself ready, and wait on me while I eat and drink. After that, you may eat and drink. Would he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you were told to do, should say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty. But here Jesus is talking about your attitude of heart. And how pride is. He's instructing his disciples, not the world. He's telling them how they need to be. And that there's offenses, there's problems, but there's going to be people who sin against you. If you're obligated, just as I forgive you without end, you're obligated to ask me for forgiveness, and I will forgive you. So if someone asks you for forgiveness, you have to forgive them. Even if it's seven times, if he does something, as long as he's repentant. Now, but we do notice, though, that it does not mention what happens if they don't repent. That's different. Now, you still need to deal with it, but what about a relationship that it's hard to reconcile with a person because they fail to repent? They do it and don't care. Well, then that's even more difficult, but you're still obligated to forgive that person, too. Because if not, if you hold on to forgiveness, you're the one that's going to suffer, not them. You're the one handed over to the torment. But as we read all these words and we consider what Jesus is teaching us and showing us all these wonderful principles, the only way we can live is, as it says in the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, which means crouched down, like asking. The humility that we have to live in. It's hard because we're full of pride, and I had my pride challenged this morning as the bus pulls up, and this bus driver who hates me, the same guy, and I don't know why, but he does this, he's done this now three times, that the often, you know, when you know your numbered bus and you can see it, like you have across the street and you're waiting for the light and you see your bus coming, you want to get to it. And so you run over there to catch the bus before it takes off because you know you might have to wait 15 or 20 minutes before the next one comes. And it can mess up your arrival time. Well, I was waiting for bus number 66 to come opposite block 19 on Jalan Jurong Kachil. And I'm running over there to catch the bus. And the driver, this Chinese man, sees me. And he looks at me, and he knows I'm running in front of the bus, running there. Everybody gets in, and the last person steps in, and I was about from where Sylvia is, they're still going. And he closes the door, looking at me. And it makes me so mad, and I went, I'm like, having to make hand motions, and he's just staring at me. And I stood in front of the bus, like, please open the door, have my EasyLink card in the air, you know. Like an idiot. It's like he enjoys the power of the door. He is the god of the door. He can open it and close it and just look at me. And finally, you know, he opened the door. So I step in and I say, thank you. And he won't even look at me. He just looks straight. I said, thank you so much. Thank you for waiting. He won't even look at me. And I thought, this guy's having a bad day. But to the same guy did exactly the same thing 2 days later. And that was today. And my pride was rising. How dare you mistreat me? Do you know who I am? And I got in there ready to give him a piece of my mind. He did the same exact thing. Finally, I'm tapping on the door with my car to get in. And you can tell he just wanted to drive away, but he's still at the bus stop. And he opens it without looking at me. And so I went and I got right up close to him and I said, thank you so much and a very good morning to you, sir. Thank you. Very kind of you. And I kept on talking to him. He refused to look at me. He wouldn't look at me. And then I got soft in my heart and I started thinking, this poor guy, what's his life like? What's he going through? And I said, no, really, sir. Thank you. Thank you for letting me in the bus. I appreciate it. And I went away like a little boy, humiliated by the master bus driver. And that's a good thing. For us to live successfully in the kingdom, we've got to allow people to mistreat us. And, you know, thoughts run through your head to validate yourself, to vindicate yourself. I can report this bus driver. I get him in trouble. I'm going to take pictures of him and write his numbers down. And I'm going to cut. No, you're not. No, you're not. You're going to give him a break. And even if he's not asking for forgiveness and he's just being outright cruel to you, you're going to stay kind. And you're going to say, thank you so much, almighty bus captain. Thank you. Thank you for your benevolence toward me. And it's when you're saying it, you're dying inside. And that's a good thing. We have to die. Just die. Just die. Die. Lord, we thank you for your kingdom. We're going to live in your kingdom. And we know we need to die to do it. To all of our pride, all of our arrogance, and all of our self-centered, self-service. And we want to be in your kingdom, Lord. We want to live your principles. We thank you for your holy word. Jesus, thank you for helping us and for leading us and letting us walk with you in this journey. We so appreciate it. Let us continue to learn from all that the gospel show us. Jesus, bless us. Let us retain all of this information in our hearts as we go from this place. Let the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon us all today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.